Two summers ago, our welcoming video for Pentecost that we have on our website featured my sailing our old boat Whitsunday Passage on Flathead Lake, speaking in what Sean and I thought was a fairly clever manner about how the wind propels a sailboat in a way resulting in sort of a joint ministry between the sailor and the breeze. You can set the sails, you can adjust the rudder, and go usually in the direction that you want to go. However, it's not always easy to get from point A to point B directly. Occasionally, you have to tack or zigzag back and forth because, for example, if you're trying to go due north and the wind is coming directly from the north, the best you can do is sail close-hauled at about a 45-degree angle into the wind in order to reach your destination. And thanks to something called the Bernoulli effect, sails on such a boat, when they are sailing into the wind, act as a wing. And in a way that remains a mystery to me, you're not actually pushed in a particular direction. You are pulled into that direction by what is called lift. And that allows you to sail into the wind. The physics behind it are absolutely amazing. The whole point behind what we were trying to say in this video was that notwithstanding the skill of the skipper, it is the wind that really does determine how and where you go. So it is with the Spirit driving the church. We follow where it lifts us all, and sometimes that can be to places that are particularly challenging. Well, we thought that was a pretty interesting way to welcome people and show off Flathead Lake and the Flathead Valley. And then as a last line, after inviting people to come to the services, I also said, well, maybe we could also get you out on Flathead Lake for an evening sail. Two folks took me up on that suggestion last year. And of course, if you're going to go sailing on an otherwise lovely evening, you probably never bother to ask, what could possibly go wrong? Well, to begin, once we got out there, we were hit by a microburst. And a microburst is this violent downblast of wind that then becomes an outburst, in that once it hits the surface of the earth, in this case, Flathead Lake, it moves in every direction out from the point of impact at lightning fast speed. Now, you want to avoid one of those, if at all possible, but of course, we did not. And in the second in which it was hitting it, it managed to break this bolt, 3/8 of an inch of steel, holding one of the stays or the shrouds that keeps the mast intact. You don't want to lose your mast, for example, when you're sailing. It in itself is just not a good thing. The second thing that happened simultaneously, which kind of took our mind off the fact that one of the shrouds was now flapping in the distance, is that the boat nearly capsized, with all of us being tossed from port over to starboard, landing in a heap, the three of us. And as we were tipping over, I thought, huh, well, this is what it's like to capsize. I couldn't believe I was so calm about it. I've never experienced that, even though I've been sailing admittedly smaller boats since I was in junior high. Now, here is why this is a sermon on faith, tying into the reading from the Gospel according to Mark that we had this morning. Many years ago, when Janine and I picked up this boat in Salt Lake City, we were told by the previous owners that Catalina 22s, 22-foot long sailboat, were incapable of capsizing, especially an old one like ours. And the reason why is due, again, to the physics of it all, the fact that if your boat is heeling over like this, the wind begins to just spill out of the sail, and so the force is no longer there, and the boat will actually right itself. So I've held that fact somewhere in my mind for the last 35 years. And I got to tell you, such assurance is pretty easy to file away when the boat is sitting on a trailer, or you are tied up at a dock, or you are in a nice summer evening breeze enough to keep you moving along at kind of a steady clip. All things being equal, this faith in what they said about that particular boat concerning its stability is nearly academic when there is no danger to speak of. However, when you lose total control, when your wits have failed you completely, when you are beyond anything you have ever seen in all your life of sailing, that's when having this faith can be kind of a challenge. And I'm guessing that the disciples in their boat were not a whole lot different than I was that evening last summer. Not unlike me, prior to the microburst, I'm guessing that they had thought that they had seen nearly everything. You don't fish for a living without having had some rough days on the water. You don't go sailing on the Great Salt Lake for all the years we did without having some pretty horrific winds. Now, interestingly, their boat was about the same size as ours. While in Israel, on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, our band of pilgrims actually saw a 2,000-year-old fishing boat that had been buried in the mud and just recently discovered and excavated and preserved, and there it was for us, about 2.5-3 feet bigger than ours. As well, the lake itself over there is about half the width, length, and depth of Flathead Lake. So it is a little smaller, but you can still get in some fairly significant trouble far away from the shore. But in their case, they had one other curiosity that I did not have. They were sailing to an area known as the Gerasenes on the east side of the lake, the northeast side of the lake. And in the next story in Mark that we hear immediately following what we listened to this morning, we hear they were greeted by a man who was possessed by demons. So nothing in this particular story that we heard today concerning this boat trip was really all that comforting. With a terrible wind rising mid-sail, the possibility of sinking had to have been front and center on their frantic minds, as it was on my mind late last summer. And in their case, instead of sharing in the alarm or helping steady the boat, our Lord just decided to take a nap. Do you not care that we are perishing? I think what the disciples said was a little bit more colorful than that, and that Mark probably cleaned it up a little prior before publishing it. That's just a hunch, but that's the gist of it. Do you not care what's happening to us? And then Jesus calmed the wind with the single word, peace. And he looked at them and he said, why are you afraid? Have you still no faith? And here is where it really becomes a remarkable story. It is true that he calmed the storm. It is true, in fact, that he put them in a dead calm. But that being said, he did not call upon them to have faith that he could just still the sea. He called upon them to have sufficient faith to weather the storm. Remember that they were not allowed to just stay becalmed, which is sailor talk for standing still, not going anywhere. They did have places to go. They had people to see. They had work that had to be done. So having sufficient faith would allow them to keep going and doing what it was that they had been called to. You know, I kind of think of a racing heart where adrenaline just causes it to beat faster than normal. That's part of life. And when you are being driven in ways that can feel really uncomfortable. Even so, you really never want your heart to become deadly still. Dr. Carpenter can tell you why that's the case if you are wondering. That is not the preferred alternative to life. Instead, you want to keep going, not believing necessarily you happen to have what it takes, but that Christ working through you has the moxie to endure any storm that's in front of you. Now, to return to my experience with my 45-year-old boat. Hoping to have steady breezes around 4 knots, which makes for a very comfortable sail, is usually not the case on Flathead Lake. It's not in the cards. In fact, given that the mountains are just to the west of it and summer's propensity for thunderstorm, its winds can often be like a squirrel who has just had way too much chocolate and caffeine. So you have to be somewhat on guard when you're sailing, but you also have to accept on faith that the boat will, in fact, right itself. Now, having survived nearly capsizing, that's going to be a lot easier for me. And you would have to guess that the disciples, having experienced Jesus calming the wind and then continuing them on their journey, allowed them to pick up a brand new sense of faithfulness as well. So maybe to bring all this home, there are at least two things to keep in mind, I think. The first is that you and I together are part of the body of Christ. We say that probably every week. And that means, though, among other things, that we have among us, when the going gets tough, those with the ability to see us through it, whatever is in front of us. So there are those who can calm the storm, letting the rest of us all catch our breath when we are so frightened. And the second thing is this. As Episcopalians who have been in this area since 1895, maybe even before that, we do have a track record which most certainly has included times in which we felt like we are just tipping over. And yet through calm and storm, through trial and triumph, we've sailed well through the complexities of life. And in the course of it, we have in fact had our Lord leading us all the way. And as a result, we have freed the captive, we have soothed the suffering, we've given care to the afflicted, we have fed the hungry, we have housed the homeless, and filled the suffering heart with joy that is overflowing with the grace of God. All this means, of course, is that we can always carry on. For quite frankly, our Lord is always in the bow of this boat, making the way for hope and joy, which always, always conquers fear and despair. Amen.